But it tastes really good at a con.
This is very high up.
I know. I feel like I like.
Like, this is a lot higher than.
I feel like I should just like breathe on it.
Like a lot higher than
it
should be.
Right?
Well, considering we're in a chair together.
It'd be a good place to cast a spell.
I
don't
know if I'm going to have to step up. Like, I
can
even step up. I'm a giant.
I know. I had to get help. Scott was a gentleman, though. He helped me.
Like, if I step up, like, not about you. It's about the damn baby.
It's, I know.
I'm telling people the baby is mine.
Yeah, okay. I feel really tall. I don't know what this is like. It feels really strange.
I'm talking on a microphone.
I feel intimidated.
Why?
Because you're taller.
I know, right? That's what I said. It would be a good place to cast a spell from. Like one of those spells where you have to breathe it out. Like.
or do Black Star be like, I'm
Yeah. Well, he would stand on the table and touch the ceiling.
Yeah.
He'd find a way to get on top of the building. Which I'm not going to attempt to do because I'll break my neck again. Yeah.
You broke your neck?
I have broke my neck before. You guys don't know?
What happened?
I got in a car wreck.
Oh, that sucks.
I didn't know you could recover.
Yep. Yeah, you can. I fractured my C2.
Oh. Why, you ain't lucky?
At least you're okay. You
know, yeah, I'm good. Serious. I just have limited movement to the left, but nobody notices anymore. It's creepy.
I don't do
it. Oh.
Yeah.
I can't. This is as far as I go.
Yeah. Okay, I go about right here.
About right here.
On that side, because my vertebrae fused, because it wouldn't have happened if I wanted to a halo, but I don't want the scars from the halo.
Ouch.
And the rashes that you inevitably get from the chest piece. Yeah, and then they drill holes into your skull and then screw this thing in to keep your head straight. So instead I opted for what is called a hard brace, and it was kind of like crooked, and I didn't know it. It wasn't on even things for a while, and nobody wanted to adjust it because I would like scream at them because it hurt. And so it was crooked for probably like 3 weeks of healing, and so it healed like this, and because that's where I broke it, and I was like, it hurts, and I put it on like this, and so it fused on the left side, which is why I can't turn that much there, but I could turn really abnormally far to the right. So it was a gamble.
Wow.
And it's kind of creepy. That's a creepy part, is this.
Ooh, ow.
Is it creepy? I can go farther, but I want to freak y'all out. Anyway, the only reason I'm talking on this mic is because I could scream, but I would not like to. But I would feel, even though y'all are right in front of me, I feel like I would need to scream.
No.
Because I'm weird. But anyway, yeah.
Join a club.
Yeah, what?
Join a club.
Yeah. I'm like, you're right in front of me! Hey! I love you! So how are y'all doing?
Good.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, this is I like to do these question and answers. And so they're Q&As. So I will provide A if you provide Q, you provide Q and I provide A, or I talk about pizza and things I like to eat.
Oh, yay, pizza.
Yeah, anchovies are really good. Just don't knock it till you try it. Anchovies and capers, but the capers are salty. Okay, so questions? Yes?
Yeah, how is Chris Evans in person?
He's very gentlemanly. Yeah, he's really nice. He's kind of the all-American guy. He's a very, when I worked with him, it was one of those things where I wasn't going to start conversation because, you know, I just, a lot of times with actors that are that big, they just think they're so special, they don't need to talk to you. And so I just kind of expected that, which, because, you know, it could happen, and that's usually what happens. So I was just like, okay, well, he's going to, you know, kind of be a jerk, and I'll just pay attention to myself and then have my lines down, and, you know, it'll be smooth. And actually, he started a conversation with me, and he, like, throughout shooting, brought me water, and we were doing this, the scene in Puncture where I have, like, my one line, pretty much, or not one of my only lines were, no, not that part, but when we're in the office, and in the 80s, the GPOs, that line, I was bending down over and over again on the carpet, and it was, like, the school carpet, the really rough, like, hard school carpet, you know, and I wasn't really going to say anything because it's a really high level shoot, and I was bending down over and over again. If you've seen it, where I'm in the back and I'm putting away the books, and I bend down on the floor and then I get up. I was doing that same movement over and over again, and I had like I was almost bleeding on my knees, and I just wasn't gonna say anything. And he was like, "Hey, will somebody give this girl a knee pad? She's not gonna say anything. She really needs a knee pad." He's just a really nice person. Went out of his way to be nice, and was just an altogether stand up guy. I very much support Captain America. Because he's one of the few famous people that deserves it.
He's good.
Yeah. And not just because he's really talented and everything, but just an actual, genuinely nice person. Doesn't happen a lot. A lot of those people, in order to get where they were, stepped on a lot of faces.
Yeah, but he was the Human Torch, too.
Yeah, he was the Human Torch. And now he's Captain America. A little bit of a conflict for him, but I think that he, it didn't really take a step sideways. I would definitely say he took a step up, because he's a really awesome and super good-looking Captain America. And I had to put in the good-looking thing, which is totally irrelevant, but dang. Oh, I know. I know a problem with that. My husband's really good-looking, too. Yeah, that's what I think. Anyway. Yes?
Pick any two character that you wish to see have a conversation with. And do a scene like it.
Oh. See, when people ask me to do this, I tell them, you have to write me a script. Because I'm not an improver. I'm a you show me a script and then I act it out kind of person. But not only that, but coming up with two different voices and not mixing them at the same time and two different characterizations and all that stuff is really hard to do on the fly. So I would need a script from whoever you guys wanted to do it from. But I think it would be interesting. Let's see, two characters. See, and these are also, like, you have to think about it for a while, but two characters that would be interesting to introduce to each other. I think it would be neat to introduce Makoto Misaka from Railgun to Icarus from Heaven's Lost Property. She would be really irritated with her. She would be like, why do you have no emotion? Put on some clothes, have some decency. It would be funny. It would be really, really funny. She would be like shocked and bored. I mean, Makoto wears shorts underneath her skirt. I mean, and then, you know, Icarus, it's like, how does that top stay on? And it's just programmed into her. She doesn't even think anything of it. And then not only that, but the music is so emotional and explosive, and Icarus is so void of emotion. It would be really interesting to see them try to hang out without, you know, Misaka shocking the crap out of her eventually. Like, no, smile! Ah! You know, it would be funny, I think, and very interesting. But yeah, I'd say them two together would be really interesting. If you ever wrote me a couple little lines, I wouldn't mind doing it. But it was one of those things where I'd have to take space in between to make sure I actually change character. Because I only ever record one character at a time. Even when you have characters that you're playing two of them and they're talking to each other in a scene, you record them at different times so they don't sound the same. But yeah. Anybody else? Questions? I love pizza. Pepperoni. I really like roasted garlic on a pizza. I'm sorry, guys. Just if you have a question, let me know. I'll just keep talking about food. I like food. It's my favorite sport is eating. People are like, what sport do you like to play? I'm like, eating. I don't like to be active. How are you? But yeah, I'm like, what? Running. I can eat. Eating is good. Yeah, okay, now there's questions. See, eating is good. Yes?
Yeah, have you seen the, for the guest list on the Metricon?
I haven't checked that out yet.
Yeah, I know Rufio, he's back from the Metricon.
I like him a lot. Yeah. I like him a lot. He's also an outstanding person. Yeah. And very artistic. And, very just interesting and artistic and very outstanding guy. It's nice to see the stand-up ones, because sometimes people might seem that way, but they're not in the background. You're like, oh, you're kind of a jerk. But that's not the case with him. He's very awesome.
Yes.
Yeah. Sometimes, you know, every now and then fame gets to people's heads, and they forget that they're just a normal human being. But, because there's people, so many people that tell them how wonderful and more special they are than anyone else, but they let that go to their head, and they actually believe it. And that would be a mistake. Everybody needs to eat a piece of humble pie every now and then. Just realize you're just a person, but it's very nice whenever you meet people that would have more of a reason than maybe other people to feel that way about themselves, and they don't. They're just so down to earth, and they're just wonderful, and they're very caring and very sweet and very considerate, and they appreciate their fans. And, like, you know, Dante is one of those. He truly appreciates it, and that's wonderful. It's just, like, outstanding to have no good people. Like Scott. Scott, you know, who you guys just saw. He's one of those people, too. It's nice. It's refreshing. But, yeah, yes?
Are there any projects or voices you're going to do in the later future?
Let's see. I know I was asked this recently. Batum came out recently, and I play Himiko in Batum. Maria Hollick, I play dorm supervisor, which is God. No, but that's what she calls herself, God. She tells people, you can call me God. I have to tell you, because I don't want you guys to think I'm going to get struck by lightning. It's actually in the script. So I'm not. I do say I'll surpass God all the time, too. Okay. I get scared when I sign that on things. I'm like, I don't want to die. Here, you take it. let's see. What else is new? It's hard to know what comes out, you know? Like, I'm working on a bunch of projects right now, but I know that a lot of them aren't out yet or haven't been released. And you got to be careful because it's sticky if you don't know if it's been released. Oh, wait. Yupote. That one got released recently. And that was really cool if you guys haven't seen it. The girls are guns. And, like, there's, like, you know, there's, like, the main guns that each country uses. There's a Britain, there's a Switzerland, and then there's a America. And so, like, the America is the M16, right? And then what is the British gun that they use that always jams up and has all these problems, but they still use it?
It's called an SAS.
Yeah.
It's an SAS.
So then there's a character that's the SAS, you know, and it's funny because she's always messing up and jamming up like the gun does, but she's like, because she is a gun, but she's a person. It's really cool. It's very, very interesting. You learn a lot about guns when you do it, and it's really, if you like guns like I do, it's a fantastic show. It was directed by Laraldo, and I don't know if you guys know him. He's also a voice actor, and he's a terrific director, and it's wonderful. And there is a new director coming out that I can't announce yet that is just, I'm so happy to work with her, and she is so amazing. And I cannot wait till you guys know, because she is just going to put her magic touch on some projects. Just like Laraldo, just like Chris Ayers, man. I love working with Chris Ayers. He just treats every project, no matter how, you know, some other director might pick up a project and be like, you know what, this project's crap. I don't care about this project. He treats every project like it is gold. And it comes out like gold because he does, because he cares about it. It's nice to work with someone that actually cares about what you're doing. It's not good to go in to record for something that you might think is really cool, but they don't. And they're just like, whatever, that's fine. Next. And then people are like, wow, you really did a horrible job on that. And it's like, it's not my fault. I didn't try. He took every first take. I didn't know what to do. Because that happens. And you know, you can't do anything about it. So, or you're like, yeah, can I please redo that? And they're like, no. And I'm like, but I said the character's name wrong. No? Okay. You know, sometimes it happens. You're like, I didn't even say the right name. You know, you get a character that says that the name of the character is you. And it's like, stop, you! Hey, it's you! 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 It gets really confusing! Sorry, I'm screaming. I got really into that. Look at Shattered Angels. I play a character called Ku. It's K-U-U. And, but she's void of memory, which is why they call her Ku, which I guess that's what that means.
It means
Yeah, it means void, so devoid of memory, void. But when you're saying it in English, it gets really confusing. Because, you know, it's like, I love Yuku. You're like, what? Yuku? Who is Yuku? Oh, that's me. Whoops. Sometimes the names get a little like, oh. I think one of my favorite names now that I really just, I've been really into names lately, and I love the name, and I think it's so beautiful. Though it would be so confusing probably if I ever named one of my kids it, but, because, you know, I'd be like, what? A Polish Mexican with a Japanese name. I'm very confused. But is Chizuru. So beautiful, isn't it? That I have from Hakuoki. And that one's more recent. I'm trying to think. AKB0048, I play Orine. Wendy in Fairy Tale. Probably haven't seen a lot of people here since I've done Wendy in Fairy Tale. Sorry. There's so many. And you have to kind of like go through them and see, has this been released? I almost said something and I was like, I shouldn't say that. And it almost said something else. I was like, hey, the next con I go to, though, they'll probably be, you know, released by then or maybe in a few. And there's some really good stuff coming up, y'all, that is, like, I'm so excited about. I just recorded something, and I was like, I fell in love with this character. I fell in love with this girl. She is insane. And it's so fun to play those crazy off-the-wall characters like Himeko from Pony Pony Dash. Like, they're just crazy. Like, what is wrong with you? Just, like, they're so interesting and fun to play, you know? And it depends on, you know, I always have fun when I'm playing a character. I have fun when I'm playing, you know, Icarus. She was a challenge because she's so void of emotion that I had to change everything about myself to do it. I had to stand there in the booth like a blow-up doll because I had to, like, not move, because when I speak just normally, I have so much intonation in my voice, and I'm bubbly, and I'm, like, everywhere, and I'm, like, ah, like, all the time. And she is whispery and, yes, master. And everything is just, like, a whisper and very void and very, and he would be, like, no, too much emotion. I'm, like, dang it. Yes, master. Nope, nope, do it again. Damn. Okay. Yes, master. Okay, that's good. You take it. Oh, like, ah! It was really hard to do. And, you know, all of them are fun when they're a challenge, but I think some of my favorite ones are the really bratty ones, like Black Star, or like Yamada from B.IHK. I love playing just brats that are just hilarious, that are just like, I can't believe she just said that. What a jerk. Those are really fun. And then I also like ones that are just crazy off the wall and insane, where, like, everybody in the whole entire show is normal, except for your character. And if you're like, what is wrong with this girl or boy or whatever? Like, this one character is, you know, it's fun to be the laughingstock. So, yeah, yes?
What's your favorite line from Soul Leader? And it doesn't have to be Black Star, it could be anyone's.
Well, I don't know. I've never had asked that with other people's. I know my favorite line is, but I have a couple favorite lines as Black Star. But I do, one that I really like is, I just like the scene. You guys know the scene where they introduce Death the Kid, and Blackstar and Soul try to work together, but obviously they can't do that, and, like, every time that, like, Blackstar tries to lift up this scythe, he just bleeds off a nose, and just, like, it's craziness, and he's like, ah, like, the whole time. I lost my voice, like, 3 times in that scene. And at the end, all of a sudden, they have, like, bubbles, and it turns into, like, the yaoi, you know? Just for a second, just for a millisecond, and it turns into the yaoi, and he's like, can we still be friends? And you know what I'm talking about? And they start running towards each other really in slow-mo, and Soul, okay, so Soul's recorded in there at the time. Black Star is not, so when something is recorded, it's in English, it's already placed in, and then something's not recorded, it's in Japanese when we hear it, when we preview it. So this is my preview. And it's Micah hitting notes that I've never heard a man hit. Like Michael Jackson-esque. Like, blah! I'm like, oh my God, Star, right? Like, these high pitch. And then the Japanese is in, and you must hear this at least see this part of the Japanese, because the I'm sorry, the girl in Japanese goes, so. And I could not stop laughing. They were like, seriously, Brittany, let's take it. I'm like, okay, I got it. I can't do it. They had to take out the Japanese because I could not stop laughing because it was way too funny. But, you know, when he does that, and then Death the Kid is like, can I shoot them? Like, what's going on? That's a really good part. I think one of my favorite lines is when, before Sid is kind of a good guy, you know, when they're trying to find him and he's a villain for a little while. And I hope I'm not giving away spoilers to the entire show for you guys. So, okay, yeah. And online, maybe edit this out in case I'm giving away spoilers if you put this online. Is whenever he goes, oh yeah, I put a rating because of what I'm about to say. Yeah, everybody's mostly adult here.
Yep.
Okay. He goes,
20 in December.
Well, it's on Toonami, so I figure you could do it, but I don't know if they use the... Well, I'll explain it afterwards. I don't know if they used one version that was more PG or if they used the other version. But he goes, Blackstar goes, is that Sid's grave? We should piss on it. And I think that is the funniest thing. I was like, I get to actually say that word? That's really wrong. Aren't we going to put this on, like TV? Isn't that? So we did another version with spit, but I didn't know if they were going to do the spit version or the... I don't know what's on Toonami, which version, because... It's piss, right? They kept piss, which is hilarious. Are you serious? I thought that was so funny, because if I was a boy, I would do that. I would have actually gone as far as to be on the grave, though. That would have been me. Because he's alive. It's funny. Like, it's not actually, like, peeing on someone's grave. He's totally alive and walking around, which is so hilarious. He's going to come back and be like, did you piss on my grave? You seriously piss on my grave? It's got pee on it, and I know it's yours. Nobody else here would do that. Was a Tsubaki. Soul wouldn't do that. It was you. It was you, Black Star. So I thought that's a really funny, very funny moment. Another funny moment, but not necessarily funny line, but another one of my favorite moments about Soul Eater is whenever Blackstar cheats on trying to get the test answers. So he cheats and he gets all the answers. So he gets the literal crap beat out of him. Like, he's all bruised and horrible looking and like bleeding out of all these orifices. And they hang him up on the chalkboard. Sid hangs him up on the chalkboard. And Soul is taking the test and he's like, so Blackstar's my buddy, man. Blackstar's gonna tell me all the answers, right? So Blackstar digs out a bloody booger and starts writing on the chalkboard really slowly with it. And Soul's like, oh my god, the bell's about to ring, but it's cool because he's gonna give me the answers. It's gonna be awesome, it's gonna be awesome. And he's waiting for the answer. Blackstar's just like, and then the bell rings, and he was writing his name. He was writing his autograph. I loved it. That was an awesome part. Just like, yeah. But anyway, that's kind of a little bit off on that. I went on a Blackstar tangent. But it was a wonderful moment of, that's so funny. Like, he's just writing his name. It's such a jerk. Yeah, but if it was someone else's lines, I think we really enjoyed Excalibur. We enjoyed him immensely. And we would, like, play Troy Baker for a little while, like, in pre-roll before we recorded, like, over the beginning of something when it was doing all the music. He would just turn down the music and then play him, and he'd be like, perhaps it's a golden Tuesday. No, it was definitely a Wednesday. A relaxing Thursday. He would just play that for a really long time before we recorded because I thought he was so funny. It was pretty impressive. I think he was hilarious.
But yeah.
So anyway.
Any other questions? It's taped on.
That's why. Yes. Yes?
Yeah, when you did the movie, Punction. Any practical joke or any funny thing happened behind the scene with?
And that was a pretty serious movie on that one. It was really serious. There was one person there that had done a lot of soap operas that really thought she was hot stuff. Which was, you know, that's what I'm saying, you know, that it's funny when you go on sets like that because you're so unimportant to certain people. But then, you know, the one person there that is the most famous and actually, like, literally, he is the A-list actor and everyone else is at least a B. And, you know, he's the one who's nice. And then the one who's, like, barely anybody and I've never seen you in your soap opera is a total jerk. And what was funny was she was getting her makeup done in front of me. This is my second movie I'd ever been in, was Punctured. So I just happened to get a really good role because I probably don't want to cast it out of California. But, you know, everybody was very happy with my performance. And I wasn't, you know, I don't ever take myself so seriously that I'm just like, oh, working with these amateurs. I'm like, you're not going anywhere, lady, please. But anyway, so she's sitting in front of me and purposefully being a jerk. And so she's getting her makeup done and I'm getting touched up. And we're on couches right, in, like, this far, closer than this from each other. And she's like, I just don't understand why we have to work with all these amateurs. And so I, being a jerk that I am, was like, oh my gosh, this is my second movie. I am so excited. Is this your second movie too? And the lady doing her makeup knew that I was just being a jerk. And she goes like this. And looks at me like, did you just do that? And the lady was like, and I was like, and I thought it was so funny. I was like, that just, but, you know, I put her in her place. Like, who the heck do you think you are? Like, you're so special you can talk crap about me right in front of me. It's cool. I'll make you feel stupid. So not only am I an amateur, this is my second movie. Do you feel less important now? Yeah, because that's what I was heading for. But it was so funny. And, you know, we were on set and she was trying to talk crap about me to Chris Evans. And you could, like, see it. And he's like looking over like, whatever. Like, this lady thinks she's really important. And the thing was, it's like, maybe if I recognized you, man, but I don't watch soap operas, and I have no idea who you are. So you might be a big deal where you come from, but you need to eat some humble pie and chill out on your being rude. Because she was doing it in front of me on purpose. Because she could not believe she had to be in a scene with someone that no one knows. I was just like, oh, lady, please. Blah. So that was, I just had to take it even farther. I was like, oh my god, this is my second movie. Oh my god! I just really overdid it. makeup looked at me like, like she was like, I'm gonna have to deal with this woman. Why are you doing this? And I just had to make it worse. I just had to, because she was being so rude. And I was just like, this is my second movie ever. Is this your second movie too? It was just really fun. Yeah, I got her good. I felt good afterwards. Yeah. I was like, I bet our pay rate is the same. Jerk. But anyway, that's what's funny about it, though, is that my experience with her was not good. But my experience with the actual famous person that was on the set, the actual A-list, top-of-the-line actor, was that he was super personable, a gentleman, and a very sweet, very nice person to talk to. And he did not have an air of I'm better than you about him whatsoever. And, you know, I was like, that's why you're famous and she's not. Because nobody wants to work with that. And you are personable and you know how to treat a human being. And that's why you're going to be famous and you're going to be top of the line, because that's the difference between you two. And that other lady can work as hard as she wants, but the more she acts like that, she won't go as far.
She won't be in the Avengers.
No, because nobody wants to work with somebody who just thinks they're so special. They sit there complaining about everybody else on the set that is getting their big break. You know, who are you? You didn't have a big break at one time? Or did someone treat you like that so you think that you're allowed to act like that? Well, you know. That's a difference, and she hasn't gone anywhere since, because I don't see her anywhere.
There's people out there that have a false sense of entitlement.
Well, there's voice actors that do, and I'm like, man, you come on, dude. You're not Captain America. Why do you act like that?
I
don't understand. You're not that special. You're just a human being.
I don't mean to be upsetting anyone who's a big fan.
Oh. That's a testy subject, though. I've actually had really good experiences with him.
Every single experience I've had with him has been terrible.
Yeah, really?
This is
on videotape, guys.
Oh, but he's an okay guy. He really is. He's an okay guy in doses, but if you catch him when he's having a bad day.
I've never had a horrible experience, but I've heard from fans things, but that doesn't, you know, with me, I've never. He's always been a very nice person to me, and I've seen him care about his fans quite a bit. So I don't know about that subject, but I've seen voice actors that are very full of themselves, and it's hilarious. And I'm just like, you need an entourage? Really? You flew out your whole entourage because you're that special? Because I'll tell you what, my husband doesn't watch voice acting, and he has no idea who you are. He don't know. But you know what? He knows what Wolverine is. He knows who Scott is. Scott's not a jerk. He's awesome. But that's how I play that game, you know? So, you know, everybody needs to eat a little piece of humble pie every now and then. I don't care how famous you are. But that's the thing about Chris Evans. That's what I can say about him. Truly go out and support him as an actor, because he is truly a good person. And it's nice. And it's refreshing. You know? So, yeah, go see Captain America. Even if you think it's a horrible movie for whatever reason, just support him in general, I would say. Because if you want to support someone who really deserves to be famous, he does. From my point of view. He did not have to be nice to me. Surely didn't have to bring me a glass of water or get me a knee pad. You know, but he's just a good person. So, yeah. But, yeah. Anybody? Questions? Questions for answers? Yes?
If you had a superpower, what would it be?
Ooh, superpower. All kinds of stuff. People always say, see through clothes. I would hate that superpower. I would hate that. Oh, some people, you don't want to see underneath their clothes. You're like, you know, you look kind of hairless, but underneath there, I can't see anything. Just hair. It's like a hair costume underneath that. I don't know what my superpower would be. It wouldn't be to hear in people's heads. I read the Sookie Stackhouse novels. It'd be awful to know when somebody was just faking nice to you, or to know what they really thought about you all the time. I love ignorant bliss. So, you know, if you think I'm an awful person, just tell me whatever you want. I like that. I'll accept that. That's good. I don't need you to pee on my canvas. I got a canvas here I'm painting. I don't need your pee on it. But what else? So I know ones that I wouldn't want. I wouldn't want to fly because I'm afraid of heights. But I think it'd be cool to become anybody that I wanted just for the day. Maybe not necessarily change a voice, but just like, you know, look like someone else, and I don't know. I think that could be fun. Shape-shifting would be cool. Yeah, I would want to shape-shift into animals, too. Just for a little while. You know how fun it would be to be a dog? All you have to do is eat and pee, poop, and eat. I mean, my dogs. They get to sleep in my bed, get hair everywhere. It's awesome. I mean, I'd want to be one of my dogs. I don't really know about all dogs because some don't get treated. But see, if you're a shapeshifter, you could just, like, somebody treats you bad or, like, actually you shapeshift into a human and be like, yeah, I'm naked. Like, you know? How shocking would that be? It'd be horrible for a person. They'd be like, teach you to beat animals. You never know who's your grandma. I could just shapeshift into his grandma. And then he'd be like, shocked. And then I'd be naked and he'd be like, yeah, take that. I'm sorry. Anyway, this is random. Well, if you shapeshifted from a dog into a human, you'd have to be naked.
True.
Because you would be wearing any clothes.
We had to go on Granny yet?
Well, yeah, because that person's beating the dog. See, if I was a dog that someone beat, then I would shapeshift into their grandma so they could see their grandma naked.
Oh.
It would be a good vengeance.
No, no, no.
And anyone who beats animals deserves it anyway. I don't care.
True.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, or grandpa. I don't know. Whatever would be more shocking. I don't know. I think grandma usually works.
Oh.
Yeah. My boobs used to be up here, Sonny. Sorry. It would be fun. That's shapeshifting, yes. Yes. I have a... Oh, thank you. I love my dogs. I have a... my first dog that I got, she is going on 10, and I've had her the whole time. And her name is Sierra, and she's a pit bull mix.
Oh.
And then I have another dog, and they're all rescues. And my other dog is a Chihuahua, and I always said I would never own a Chihuahua because my husband, I've known him since he was like 13, and he would have like a pack, a collection of Chihuahuas at his house, and they were evil. And because when you get a pack of Chihuahuas, and it depends on how you treat them, but Chihuahuas have to be trained, and people are like, no, they're little and cute, I'm going to hold them all the time, and they act like little craps. And that's the truth, and if your Chihuahua bites... It's because it's like somebody's trying to get close to its seat, and that's what you are to it, a seat. And that's I've tried to explain this to people who have Chihuahuas that are mean. They're like, oh, it's just in a bad mood. I'm like, oh, you're making excuses for a dog that just drew blood on a human. I'm just saying, it's a dog. And if you, because Chihuahuas, because they're little, tend to be treated like babies and little babies, and they think, oh, this is my human. They don't think, like, I'm the human's dog. This is my human in my seat. Don't get near my seat. I'm protecting it. I don't want you to take my seat away or my feeder because I get hand-fed from this human being. So, but that's why a lot of them, you know, they get a bad rap because they're so vicious and stuff is they're not treated with the, I'm the owner, I'm the human and all that. But I have a pit bull already, so I treated my Chihuahua the same way that I treated my pit bull, and she's an angel. And
you were comparing, like, viciousness to a Chihuahua when pit bull's just over here like, I'm an angel.
No, but you know what's funny, though, is that pit bulls, from what I've seen and the ones that I know that people own, are much less vicious than Chihuahuas. Chihuahuas are, they have little man syndrome, and they bark, and they'll bite, and they'll, but people are like, oh, they're little, it's okay, they're not hurting anything. And, you know, most pit bulls that I know are very subservient, and they bow down, and they roll over, and don't hurt me, and you have to train a dog to be however they act. It's true, and I very much am a believer in that. I'm like, I think a lot of people could learn from watching the Dog Whisperer, whether they think it's bullcrap or not. There's a reason those dogs act so good. But I absolutely love my dog. So I said, no Chihuahuas, no way ever, because Matt had a Chihuahua when we first got together that would jump off the couch, go bite someone, and then come back and just, like, lay on his shoulder and, like, a parrot. And, you know, and then and the people would be like, your dog just bit me. He'd be like, well, it doesn't like you. I'd be like, no, I'm never getting one of those dogs because you're going to spoil it and it's going to bite me one day and you're just going to make an excuse for it. You know what I'm saying? I was like, I can't have that. I'm like, you know, I have to have calmness in my family. So this Chihuahua, my grandma works for a vet office and she has Chihuahuas. And she tried to take in this Chihuahua and it was horrible. They tried to adopt out the Chihuahua and the Chihuahua was horrible and just peed everywhere and chewed up everything. It was horrible. So they kept giving it back. Finally, they said, we're going to put this Chihuahua down. You have to find a home for it. So we were like, okay, we'll take her. And she was awful. She was horrible. But I was like, I'm not going to give her up because I don't, you know. So eventually I was like, she's destroyed so much and she's peed everywhere and I can't do it. So we gave her back. And Sierra was really unhappy when she was there, so I was like, I can't, you know, have my dog that I've had for 10 years or whatever. And she had these little toys that we got her that were, like, this big, like, little cat toys. And Sierra pulled one of those cat toys out and licked it for, like, 3 hours. And she really missed Lola. And so we went back to the vet, and we got her, and we've had her ever since. No, she's not horrible anymore, actually. She got trained out of it, but I've realized it's much harder to train a little dog than a big dog. It's hard to potty train them. They just will go in a corner and go pee and poop because they just don't care. And you could, like, you know, you could, like, what we'll do is we'll, like, put her side on her stomach and then kind of put her nose next to the pee or whatever. Not on it, obviously. I'm not going to put her own pee and poop on her face. That's gross. But, you know, like, smell this. You're bad. And then put her outside. And it didn't work for her. It works for the big dog, but it didn't work for her. And I'm like, what the heck do I do? And I think what I've realized is that they have really small bladders, so they have to go when they have to go. If you don't, you know, like, a big dog can hold it, but they're so little. Is what I really think it is, they can't. And so we put little pads in the house and stuff, but she usually does hold it and go outside. But that's one of those things I've learned. If you own little dogs, you might have to get pet pads for life, which is gross. And I was always like, no, it's gross. You're teaching them to go in the house. But there's no, she can't hold that, you know, all day when I'm gone at work, you know. But they're perfect. And what's funny is the Chihuahua is the boss of the pit bull. Like, she makes the rules, and she sits on the pit bull. That's her seat. And so I have a lot of pictures of her sitting on her. But yeah, sorry, I went on a tangent about my dogs. I love my dogs. And I have a cat, too, and I have two goldfish that are 6 years old. Yeah, random. Goldfish do live for a long time if you take care of them. Word. So, any other questions? Yeah.
If you could be in an anime, like a recent one, like Attack on Titan or Tokyo Swim Club, which anime would you be in?
How do you know I'm not in one of those?
Well, you know, I should know, but I'm a failure. So.
Well, not all of the casts are announced for those.
Well, that's true.
Yeah. But I would probably be in both of them if I could be in anything. I like working, so anything is good.
Would you be a gay swim boy?
Hmm?
You'd be a gay swim boy? You'd be not Lisa.
I don't know. Good question. I don't know. I would be in anything. People ask me that. I'm like, yes. Any of them. I love working. Why would I just say no? No, I don't want to work. Keep that paycheck. No, I love working. I love being in all animes. They're all fun. There's never one that I've been like, oh, I have to go to work and record anime. No, I enjoy it. Might not look forward to the drive for 5.5 hours, but that's about it. But yeah. So I like anchovies. I covered that. I'm just kidding. Anyone have any more questions? Yes.
What is your favorite scene from Angel Beats?
Angel Beats. Anytime they say shut up and die, because I think that's really funny. But it's only funny if you haven't seen the show because they can't die. So they die for like the day and they come back to life. So normally you'd be like, that's such a horrible thing to say to someone, you know, shut up and die. But I'm like, in this case, it's really funny. Like, shut up and die already. I'll see you tomorrow. You know, like, you know, and I thought it was funny when they would mess up the name, you know, welcome to the Not Yet Dead Battlefront, welcome to the Barnacle Battlefront, welcome to the, they change it every 5 seconds. Or like in the very beginning when she's just like, oh, yeah, welcome here, you're dead, by the way. You know, just like, oh, well, get over it, you're dead. Yeah. And yeah, but I think in the very beginning when she's just like, shoot these guys, you're dead, come on.
Like, I kind of like the part where it's, like, when they called her Angel, like, they didn't know that she wasn't an angel, but, it was, like, when they were, like, trying to make her fail, like, I kind of liked it how they kind of used, him as a distraction, like, make him go up to see, like,
I know.
Every time he goes up to see, they play that ending theme from that show.
I know, she's so, it's funny, because she's, like, she's, you know, because they can't die, all of her things that seem, like, really evil things to do are really that evil. They're just kind of funny. So there's a lot of comedy in that, because normally you'd be like, God, so she's such an evil character that she's going to send him up to die, but then it's like, well, she'll see him tomorrow. It's cool. But yeah, that was a really fun show. I would cosplay as her if I could, if I had, like, the money to do all that and the time, which I couldn't sew a sock, so I would do it in dental floss, probably. Mm-hmm. I used to sew patches on with dental floss, punk patches, because I'm old. Anyway, yeah.
Thanks.
What?
Old. Yeah, old.
Yeah, ancient. No, I'm not ancient. But I'm getting there. Not as young as I used to be. Just kidding. So, pizza. I like thin crust. I'm just kidding. You know, y'all have any questions? Because I'll just keep talking about pizza. You don't have any. Yes, in the back. I'll get you next. Oh, no, go ahead. Either one.
Okay.
You and then you, and then you, and then you.
All right. I love pizza as much as you do. Are there any foods that you just don't like at all?
No, I'm a garbage disposal. Yes?
Have you ever had any voice acting
Yeah, a lot of them are. Everyone has their own challenges. Some of them are just cake, because it's just like my regular voice being a brat. I'm like, oh, that sounds like me. And like Yamada, I did that. That was just cake. That was great. I loved going in for Yamada. I was like, I get paid to say this. There's so many times that she's saying something so raunchy, I had to take a picture of it and like send it to my husband and be like, I got paid to say this, yo. Because it was just awful. But yeah, like I said, Black Star was difficult because he's my first boy character ever. And also difficult because he was really taxing on the voice. And usually I would drive up to Dallas, 5.5 hour drive. I would work a 7 hour day with only a couple breaks and one lunch break. And drive back 5.5 hours. And that was my things. Then I don't have to pay for a hotel room, and all I'm paying for is gas. I went up there to try to do that with Black Star, and 2 hours in, I was like, I was like tasting blood. You know, people don't understand, that's not a really natural voice to do. I don't naturally speak like a boy, really gruff, yeah. Like, I don't speak like that normally, and so it's really taxing on the vocal cords, and, you know, you're when you naturally have emotion, your body is prepared for it, but a lot of times when you're acting and you're doing it so fast in a booth, you don't have time to necessarily prepare for the scream as much as you would if you were really afraid of something. And your body doesn't, so you have to just like kind of take a deep breath and push with your diaphragm and hope that you support it. But most of the time you have to do it 3 or 4 times and you're wrecking your voice, especially a character like Black Star where you're screaming, I will surpass God every 5 minutes. And then, you know, even just the laugh, like, ha, 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 like you're screaming all the time, the entire time. So I would go in for 2 hours and I'd be toast. Couldn't do anything. Try to do an audition afterwards and I'm like, I can't talk. It sounds like this. Like, that's it. You know, that was hard, physically hard. Technically hard, like I said, would be, like, Icarus was technically hard. But then, like, Yamada and Makoto Misaka, they're cake, they're exactly how I talk, just a bratty version of me, you know. But now the boy voices have become easier. Doing a realistic boy is really hard. Trying to play, like, not the cartoony Black Star boy, but a realistic, like, 12 or 13-year-old boy. Is definitely difficult because it's not as easy when you're not able to do the cartoon thing. It's really just a matter of changing the pattern of the way that you speak and the emphasis on what word you have in a sentence. So like a boy versus a girl, girls speak smooth and connected, like musically, and boys speak like using musical terms. Girls speak legato and boys speak staccato, and staccato would be short and separated. So, and also women speak with a lot more crispness to their voice, a lot of times more enunciation, and boys kind of run all their words together, you know, so you have to kind of take a little bit of that up. Also, women would say, I'm going to go to the store, and they put the emphasis a lot of times on the subject, and boys would say, I'm going to go to the store, and they usually put the emphasis on the action word in a sentence. So, you know, that, so it's difficult to do that. And you would do that with Black Star, but then you're also doing like a cartoon version and it's all like, and you know, so it's a little easier, it comes to you a little easier when you're doing that cartoony voice to put in the staccato and all that. But when you're doing it in your regular voice, it's really hard to take out things about your normal way of speaking and change them. So that is difficult too. But like I said, every character has their own little thing. It can be really difficult to do a realistic character. Because you're so used to being colorful and, you know, cartoony and crazy. And then there's this character that's just like, I'm dreaming. And everything is supposed to be realistic. And you just talk like you do. And that can be hard to do, too. Because, it's still a cartoon, you know, but you're making it like regular people speak. So it depends on what the role is. But every role has their own difficulties. It could just be that, like, when I recorded Monet in Numeria, it was at, like, 10 o'clock in the morning every day, and I'm screaming, like, Monet! Like, in the morning, and it was really hard, and he'd be like, well, you said Monet, you didn't say Monet, and I'm like, oh my god, I'm gonna kill you. You will die. No, I'm just kidding. But, yeah, so, it just depends on what the project is, how difficult it is. I'll let you, because you've said a couple less, and then I'll let you. Okay. I got both of y'all, right?
What's the weirdest experience you've had with a fan?
People always ask me this. For every, like, weird or odd experience, I've had a million good ones. So, and nobody ever wants to hear about the awesome experiences or all the friends that you've made throughout, you know, anime and, like, how anime conventions are a really wonderful thing. Everybody wants to hear, like, the ones that are horrible or whatever. But weird, I don't know. It'd be pretty difficult to weird me out. I think people will try, but I'm like, yeah, I'll sign your panties. Here. I don't, you know, it doesn't, you know, people think it's so funny when they bring up yaoi and yuri paddles. I'm like, it's a paddle, you know, okay. I used to use these on my horses. I don't know what you're talking about. I've signed underwear. None of them used. I think that would be weird. Oh. Yeah, because then I'd be like, oh, thank you. I'm going to go wash my hands, or at least I don't think they're used. I don't look in the crotch. Normally. No, I'm just kidding. I only smell it. No, I'm just joking. I'm just being gross. I'm just kidding. It's anime, guys. All right. Let's see. I've signed chests. I've signed faces. I don't like signing faces anymore because they're so oily that the marker doesn't work for the rest of the time. And then you're like, why did I sign that face? I've signed really weird stuff. I don't really know weird experiences. I've had like a couple creepers. I had this, this was weird. I lived in this apartment before, but it was when I was with my husband before we moved in together. And I lived in this apartment by myself, and I'd only seen this neighbor later when I found out who it was, like, once. But my dog would go and poop in his yard, okay? And he would, like, come out and have a conversation with me while my dog's, like, around. Like, it was really awkward. I'm like, oh, sorry. And, I mean, I have a bag. I picked it up. I wasn't one of those people. But it was just really strange because any time that my dog would walk into his yard to poop, he would want to come out and talk to me. I'd be like, my dog's pooping and staring at me. It's really hard to concentrate. And she's bent in the weirdest way. Sorry. Oh, I just can't imagine her. And he's like, yeah, how you doing? Like, what the heck is going on right now? But he would come out and talk to me and all that stuff. Well, one day, somebody tried to get into my apartment when I'm in my living room with a credit card, which I don't understand why they thought that would work. These are not electronic. It was a really old building, and they're deadbolts. But you could see the card come in, and it moving up and down trying to get in the building. So I walked over, and I grabbed the card, and then I called the police. And you could hear the person run downstairs, and I was just like, okay, well, here's the card. The card was stolen. And then a couple days later, I got a note on my car. And it was like, I'm a really big anime fan of yours, and I'd love to get together sometime, but it didn't have a name or address or who it was. It was just like, love your biggest fan. It's like, that's kind of creepy, because it's on my car at my house. It's not like mailed to the studio, or this is really weird. Okay. So, you know, my husband, who's my boyfriend at the time, is like, just freaking me out. So he's like, gotta collect it and go tell the police. But then the next day, I got one in my door. And so this person had graduated to walking inside and up the stairs to my apartment and putting the letter in my door. And it was the same thing, and it was like, I'm a biggest fan, I love these roles that you do, and I'd really like to talk to you, and someday can we meet and sign your biggest fan. And I guess at this point, my husband, who was my boyfriend at the time, had noticed that this neighbor had no furniture in his house, had been living there for about half a year, had a bunch of people come over at a time, but there was nothing in there. Like, he would leave his door open, but there was a computer and a cushion to sit on the computer and nothing. Their whole house was empty. And he rented the biggest apartment in the entire area. It was, like, on the corner. And then I was like, yeah, that guy really does come outside all the time to talk to me when my dog's pooping in his yard. Like, the minute my dog goes to poop in his yard, he's outside. It's very strange, all different times of the day, whatever. And so he kind of, like, started suspecting it. Well, I got another letter, and whenever this letter came in, my husband, boyfriend at the time, ran outside and saw the guy walking to his house. So it was my neighbor. My husband took the letter and hawked a big loogie on it and stuck it to his door. And the guy saw him do it, and it never bothered me again. And he moved out shortly afterwards, but it was a very creepy thing. And it was very like, maybe I should call the police. But I was like, no, it's the same guy who tried to stick a credit card in my door to open it. So I guess I'm not really worried about him. He doesn't seem very bright. I want to talk to you. I'm not going to tell you who I am. Like, I don't know. Weird, but anyway, that's a weird experience. But I'm not one of those people that's like, oh, creepy stalker, I was so scared for my life. I was like, I have a gun. I don't care. Sorry, let's play. You can meet my AR. It's friends. But yeah, so that was a weird experience. I've never had a like really weird experience. Nobody weirds me out. I'm just like, oh, you're eccentric. That's fun. So am I. I guess if for someone to weird me out, they'd have to be weirder than me, and I doubt that is possible. I'm very strange. But anyway, yeah, yes.
Like I know you did Infamous Stratos as Cecilia Alcott. What's it like playing her, a British character who's stuck up and stuff?
Fun. I'm not really good at British accents, so Matt Greenfield, who directed that, would have to like tell me, pretty much give me a line read. But when he did it, he sounded like Mary Poppins. So she came out a lot sounding like Mary Poppins, like a really fake British accent, but funny. And that was the funniest part about it, because when he did it, it sounded like Mary Poppins. You know, it was like Mary Cecilia Alcott. And so I would do it like that, and I had a great time. That was a very fun role, and she's adorable. And though she's acts really stuck up and everything, it's endearing because you know she's really just really insecure about herself, which is usually the case with someone who acts really stuck up. They need like some sort of, yes, I'm awesome, tell me I'm awesome, because they don't think that great about themselves type of thing. But yeah. Hey, five. We got five. 5 minutes? 5 seconds? 5 minutes?
5 hours.
5 hours.
Yes. We're going to talk about pizza in 5 hours.
5 hours of storytelling in the words of Excalibur. Only 5 more hours. Perhaps it was a golden Wednesday. No, it was a relaxing Thursday. No, I'm just kidding. Anybody? Yes.
Is there anyone you worked with or worked on that you
kind of
fangirled over?
Working with Chris Evans was like really, that was pretty amazing. And though I didn't watch a lot of TV, and at the time I had like a black and white TV with no sound, it didn't mean I didn't know who he was. And, you know, I was like, oh, dude, you're the torch. And, you know, but I didn't really like geek out on him or fangirl. And the funny thing was, I actually insulted him, but inadvertently. Because the first time we went to go do a scene together, first of all, I scared the crap out of him. So, and I did this on purpose because I'm evil. So the parking garages in Houston have, a lot of them have like just a wire, and so you park in front of this wire and it's completely open and it's like floors and floors above the ground and you could see straight down, and like your car, if you drove any farther, you would just drive off into the city. Okay, and so he was kind of freaked out by this, I think, and I was driving and he didn't know, he like thought I was a lot younger than I was. He's like, do you have a license? And I was like, yeah, I'm 22, like what are you talking about? But okay, so we get in. They're like, right before they say action, I turn to him and I'm like, your life is in my hands. And I turn back and I just start driving. They say action. You know, he was like this. And they were like, Chris, you're going to need to relax on the little thing. I was like, dude, I was just kidding. I'm sorry. I had to let that joke go way too far. I'm sorry, but I just thought that was funny. But then, so we're outside later and we were talking. And, you know, he's like, oh, how'd you get in? You know, I was like, how'd you get into this? And he was telling me how he used to sing and dance and do, like, musical theater. And he's been doing theater since he was a kid with his whole family, which is a really cool, neato thing. And, you know, I was like, yeah, I used to do musical theater, too, whatever. And then I said, well, I really liked you in Scary Movie. And he goes, you mean Not Another Teen Movie? And I was like, sorry. I didn't really see it. I'm sorry. And I was like, but I think instead of him being like insulted, he was just like, hey, like somebody who wasn't like super, you know, you know, I think it might have been refreshing for him. But that's where, you know, all the conversation started. But I was like, ah, crap, I really knew which movie you were in. I just said the wrong one. My bad. You know, so, but luckily he was just such a nice guy. He wasn't like, oh, how dare you? I wasn't in that movie. But instead was just really nice about it. But yeah, so, but anyway, yeah, I get definitely geeked out. I mean, I know him and he's, gosh, he was a powerhouse. He would just turn it on, man, and act. And it was nuts. He would be like talking to you like this, and then they'd be like, action. He'd be like, just into it, just know all of this. It was so amazing. Because to me, I have to be like, okay, here's the lines. Nobody talk to me. You know what I mean? Because I'm not that experienced, and so, or, you know, especially at that time. So that, you know, I had to kind of just be in the zone, in the character zone. I can't just start crying on cue. This guy could probably just be like, they'd be like, okay, your mom died. And he would just be like, and perfect. And he was amazing. Like, it was really intimidating to be around such a powerhouse professional actor. You know, that was really neat. And in voice acting, I, you know, a lot of the people, now we're all friends. But it's really neat when you do a project and you hear someone that you've been working with for years and years. Like, I've been doing this for 10 years. And, well, almost 10 years. No, 10 years. I don't know. Wait, no, I'm probably on 9. I'm on 9 years going on 10. Started when I was 18. I'll be 28 in June. So, yeah, I'm going on 10. But I've been working with, like, Lucy Christian and Monica Rial for since the beginning of time. And then every now and then, I'll be like, who is that? And it's one of them. And I did not even know it was them because the role is so different and so unique from anything that they've done. They're just that talented. That when you have known someone and had dinner with them and hung out with them and known them for years, and they're so good, they can do parts you didn't even recognize. That's impressive. And you look up to that, you know, you're just like, wow, I really, because when I do a part, everybody's like, hey, that's Brittany, you know, but they're so talented. They can do so many, they can do high up in the sky to low down low, just amazing range of voices that, you know, now that it's released, I can say that when I saw Michiko and Hatchin, and I'm in that, I was like, that's Monica? No, it's Monica? And it was, and it was just crazy impressive. She's just so talented, you know? But yeah, so you know, I fangirl over that. But at the same time, they're my friends and they're my buddies. I'm just like, hey, dude, you did an awesome job. You know, that was really good. You know, so I definitely do have moments where I geek out a little bit. And I was really excited to meet Dante because I saw Peter Pan when I was a kid. I was like, that's cool, man, you're in that. But then I didn't want to be like, go Rufio, because you know he hears that all day. You know, but then again, I'm like, you know, I'm like, you're a really cool dude. And, you know, Johnny Young Bosch, like, of course I saw Power Rangers, but at the same time, like, you know, we're on a friend level. So, but it's neat. And of course I kind of geek out a little bit about it, but I know that probably the last thing they want to hear is for you to ask him to do a line because they hear that all day. So you're just like, yeah, you're the Ranger. Wasn't me. I didn't say it. But yeah, so there's times when I do geek out a little bit. I wouldn't want to freak him out. I'm a little midget, like, ah! They're like, oh my God, what's going on? You're so little, you're scaring me. step back. It's when you put the hand on the head, and the person's like, okay, sorry, just kidding. I said thin crust. Stuffed crust is good too sometimes, it depends. I like garlic on the pizza, marinara. Anybody? Ranch. Yes.
I put mayo on my pizza.
Ew. Gross.
Now I'm the weirder than you.
Twizzlers on pizza?
Yeah, strawberry Twizzlers on pizza.
Does it? Wow. You guys. I did have a friend that one of her pregnancy cravings was the most disgusting thing ever. She would have peanut butter and jelly sandwiches with bacon on them, but then she would eat them cold. I was like peanut butter bacon, but then you added the jelly. You freaked me out. Or maybe candied bacon. Because candied bacon would be good on that, right? But no. And it was like, the bacon's not even hot. Tori's like melting with the peanut butter. It's cold. You're a freak. You're a freak. But yeah. I think we're done. Anybody last question? Last question? Burning desires. Anybody want to eat pizza now? No, I'm just kidding. Okay. Right? Sorry, that's my go-to. Whenever nobody asks any questions, I'm like, okay, I just talk about pizza. I know a lot about pizza. I used to work at a pizza place. Okay. Anyway, thank you guys so much for the questions and for coming. And let's hang out. Woo!